Colourful British holiday camp commandant Billy Buckland buys a 300-acre seaside site near Laytown in County Meath. His aim, to build Ireland's first Buckland's holiday camp with the seductive pledge of a week's holiday for a week's pay. But in De Valera's post-war Ireland, there are still those who would disapprove of Billy's plans. The Buckland's project would introduce an undesirable and alien element into the parish and would be an evil influence in an Irish Catholic countryside. Outside influences are bad and dangerous, and people should maintain their Christian spirit and not hinder the language revival by such influences. Holiday camps are essentially an English idea, and in Ireland they're as alien as the Cockney or the Oxford accent and as undesirable. The wily Mr. B is clever enough to recognise the problem and agrees to build a Catholic church on the Mosney site. And to this day, the Irish Centre remains the only Butlin-built camp to feature a candy-coloured chapel on its list of attractions. Now everybody's happy, and on Tuesday, July 13th, 1948, Mosney Holiday Centre is officially opened with an opera, Verdi's Rigoletto, if you don't mind. It's 9 a.m. on the first morning of the 50th season. Lorraine and the Redcoats team are deliriously awaiting the arrival of their first happy campers.
So did you miss us?
No one is surprised to see Betty Bartley and her daughter Elizabeth from Beaumont in Dublin. For the Bartleys, it's a matter of intense personal pride to be first into Mosney on the first day of each new season. This year, Elizabeth's boyfriend, John, gets a share in the small triumph of being Mosney's first family for a record 20th year in a row.
Mrs. Bartley.
Hello,
Stephanie.
How
are you?
Not too bad. Are you in the same, Shelley?
You are indeed, of course.
That's grand.
Another floor, D14, Mrs. Barclay.
That's
all right. Thank you, fit you.
Can't change at all down here?
Not particularly this year, no.
Yeah.
All right. That's your keys, Mrs.
Barclay. Right.
Have a nice holiday. Thanks
very much.
Bye.
Well, I came here in 1961, and I've been coming here every year since. We were often sitting in the garden, and the next thing I'd ring, and I'd ask them, "Is any empty shellies?" To say, I'd say, "Boot me in, I'm on my way." That's why they call us the Adams family, because you never know when we're going to turn up.
But the Bartleys don't have Mosney to themselves for too long. Up at the front gate, the cars and the coach parties are pouring in. Families come back to Mosney year after year after year, and part of the appeal is its absolute predictability. So many things stay comfortably the same at Mosney, and even the gatekeeper, the first face you'll see here, has been genially gatekeeping for 40 straight years.
And my name is Willow Kinahan. I started 1953. I've been here every season since, and I enjoy meeting the people. And there's people who are coming in here and they say, 25, 6 years, the first thing they do is come over and shake hands with me. They say, are you still there? Well, at the start, the Irish weren't inclined to tack on to. They were never used to queuing up. This was just after the war, 48, we'd say. And then by degrees, the people in the south got used to it. And they started to come. And then I meet the same people coming back now for 30, 35 years, especially from the north of Ireland and Dublin.
Singing, dancing and sex. It's all enjoyment every weekend.
Is that right, Lily?
Oh, true.
We're going in a tub with a few men down the shanty.
Back in accommodation unit RD114, the Bartleys are joined by their friend Ursula from Drogheda, pretty much like they always are at around this very time every year.
Well, an average day is get up, have our breakfast, head to the slots, go from the slots into Dan Lowry's. Dan Lowry's back home here, back to the slots and the same again. And then out to Dan Lowry's at night, until about 3 or 4 in the morning, maybe 5.
We come back to the same chalet every year because it's a matter of them. When you go out, you get drunk and you're able to fall back and you know exactly where to go. You know it's the last row of chalets, so you know exactly where to come to. You know the colour of the door is blue, so when you're drunk, like, don't go to a red docks, you know, yours is blue, and it's brilliant.
You offer me Spain anywhere, and I'd rather have Mosney for the atmosphere and the entertainment.
Go!
Okay, swing your leg.
Over at the playground, Lorraine is getting to grips with a job that hasn't changed much in half a century. Well, maybe the uniforms.
We're halfway through the first day now, anyway, and we were up till 3:30 last night rehearsing in the ballroom, and up at 8:00 this morning, so I didn't think I was going to be able for it. I was really surprised. I was walking through, and everybody knows you. Nobody knows my name, but everyone's like, Redcoat, Wizkid, and they're waving at you, and all the kids are running up to you, so it's great. It's great fun so far, anyway.
It was a big deal to have Redcoat sit at your table for meals. You were allocated your table 4, row 3 for breakfast, and table 5, row 6, and so on. Right through the week, you'd have to sit at a different table, and they'd all be clamouring for to have the Redcoat at their table.
Once you were in any kind of show sphere, in the thing, and you wore any kind of a different uniform, you were noted, and then, like Tessie was saying, you would sign autographs all day, and you get photographs with everybody.
Being a Redcoat was like being a movie star in those days. I mean, you really could write your own ticket, you know. My autograph is all over Ireland. Photographs and posters and cards and cigarette packs. Death of Slayer.
Good afternoon, campers. The lovely ankles competition will commence in the ballroom in 5 minutes. All lovely ankles competitors report to the ballroom now.
Believe us, there was a lovely ankles competition and a lovely hair, lovely family, lovely mother, lovely child, and of course that old holiday camp stalwart, the lovely girls Grand Prix. Oh, looks like Derv Le Kerwin has been around a long time. And these lucky, lovely girls get to judge the lovely bald spot and the loveliest, greasiest comb over. Not to mention the most handsome man in Ireland competition. You must believe that the fine art of gurning was once akin to a national sport. Simple times indeed. May Power was a former Miss Ireland. She's now a Mosney compere.
I came down here 30 years ago as a model. I mean, believe it or not, I was only like 15 at the time. But it was very different then because the people then, they just entered on the spur of the moment. But now they actually come down ready to enter our competitions, like, say, be it the Glamorous Gran, or the Head to Toe, or the Holiday Princess. They actually come ready with the clothes, and they love it. When I was coming down first, we used to bring down long maxi dresses and parade out here on the floor in evening gowns. It wasn't on the stage. And you know, we were really made up to the nines and hair done up high and everything.
I came here about, I think, 20 years ago this year, would you believe it? I'm totally in charge of the competitions, all of the competitions.
Oliver Twist. So there's Oliver. Sabina, somebody's come with you again, look. I'm sorry, Sabina, I can't resist it.
The talent, I'll have to say, junior talent is just something else. It really is. It's been fabulous over the years, and the standard is so high.
You take an inch, I'm an amma.
Thank you very much, Claire.
The style in some of those competitions is absolutely fantastic. Some people come especially just for the competitions alone. They love coming, they love dressing up. They love going in for the competitions.
Ireland has changed dramatically over the past 50 years, especially the role of women. But at Mosney, we still have a full quota of contestants for the holiday princess. So which of these two girls is about to be judged the most beautiful?
Contestant number one! Down on the side of the stage, all of the doing brilliant. And our judges, ladies and gentlemen, the holiday princesses.
Good afternoon, campers. Calling all our chubbiest lady campers. The Miss Chi Chi competition starts in the ballroom at 4 o'clock.
Miss Chi Chi was the fattest person. Not very many people would like to win for that, but however, it lasted for quite a number of years, but then it died out, because I suppose everybody got figure conscious.
But you just have Miss Chi Chi, I want Miss Chi Chi. No, you don't have us, the fat woman. Have your eyes have yourself because I was fat and Chi Chi looking. It was cheerful, really. You know fat people are always laughing, they have nothing to laugh at, they will laugh.
Bye-bye, Miss Chi Chi. Hello, glamorous Gran. Though not all these grannies are quite as glamorous as they'd like to be.
I would have worn a nice suit or a nice dress, but they're all getting cleaned at the moment. They're all gone down to Drogheda to get cleaned. All our shallies went up and fired at night. And everything was destroyed. But what can I do? This is my daughter's tracksuit at home.
Well, a fire started, we believe, in a storeroom. It moved through the A-frame cavity above the building itself, moved at quite a fast rate. It didn't get into the actual chalets itself. But in our business, every organisation has an action plan. And you hone it and you define it, but you hope to God you never actually have to press the button. But we did. And within 7 minutes, we had everybody out. So thankfully, nobody was hurt.
Fair play to the red coats and all and the security. They looked after the kids and us, you know. Got us blankets and food and everything. No, as long as I live, I'll never forget it, but I'll still come down to Mosley, you know. I'll still come down, because the children love it.
Butlins, Butlins, Butlins by the sea.
In 1982, Butlins pulled out of Ireland. The package holiday boom had badly dented the home holiday market. But who in their right mind would buy a post-war holiday camp in the heart of County Meath?
The first time I remember it for sale was when it hit the local press. That Butlins were selling the holiday centre, and the asking price was $6 million. And that, when I just remember reading about it, and that was just way out of my league, I wouldn't be able to consider at all. Then the asking price came down to $3 million. And about 6 months later, 9 months later, the asking price came down to $1 million. And I reckoned that it was worth having a go. I have very fond memories of Butlins, our family business abroad in McCluskey's Bakery. As a young boy, I used to volunteer to the last bread run into the centre at night. And of course, I also had plenty of helpers to help me with the last run, because I don't know how we used to do it, but we succeeded in leaving the van parked in the centre while we enjoyed the facilities of the night. It's only years later I found that the Butlins would always sell it to somebody that they felt couldn't really run it. And they always sold it at a price that was so attractive that somebody would jump in and do it. And I think that's what happened in the other two or three centres they sold in the UK. They sold them at a very attractive price to inexperienced people. Of people that felt the real experience, but it failed after the first year or two. Fantropica, yes, definitely was the saving of the centre. We succeeded in transforming the old swimming pool into what became Fantropica, simply by reducing the level of water, putting steps down to it, railings around it, and putting attractions into it. It totally transformed the old pool into what we presently have as Fantropica. Mosney can't really compare with Disneyland, and we don't try to. We are what we are, and it still holds a magic, though, for children coming. I challenge anybody to stand on the Dublin Belfast Road while the coaches are turning in to see the excitement on the children's faces. And that proves that children still do want to come to Mosney.
Butlin's camps everywhere were built to the same regimental plan, except for the Irish camp. Well, we had a church, didn't we? So when Butlin's pulled out of Ireland, they took everything of value, ticked off item by item according to a standard stock inventory form. But the church wasn't on the standard inventory form, and hanging forgotten in that church was a classic Renaissance painting from the school of Italian master artist Bonifazio Veronese.
I am excited, but I wouldn't allow myself to be too excited, because it is fairly rare, if I might say so, if not exceptional, to find an Italian Renaissance painting in County Meath. It could be a very significant find, and a rather romantic one too, because millions of your viewers must have spent holidays in Butlins, and they looked at this picture which has now come to light.
We had considered possibly restoring it, cleaning it down. But then because of its value, we thought that best would be to dispose of it, because we were fearful for it maybe hanging here when people get to know its value. But we disposed of it by contracting with Christie's, and they put it in their catalogue, and they auctioned it off. But if it was today, I think I'd be retaining it for the church and safeguarding it. We'd certainly love to have it back.
Was grace that taught my heart to
a famous prayer, the Mosney prayer, Faith, Hope and Shelley Key.
But we used to sing in the choir at Sunday Mass, you know. There's a guy called Eddie Tye. He's just one of these great musicians, and he was a record, we were shared with Shelley. And Eddie was a very good keyboard player as well as a bass player. And Eddie would get the gig of playing the organ at 10 o'clock Mass on a Sunday. And the little church is still there, lovely little church on the way in. And we have to do the Mass. Now, I didn't drink, but Eddie did. So with the hangover, the heads, this says, I'm going into the Mass to sing, you know, singing a hymn to Mary, and Eddie, give him a and we're all the red coats, hangover.
My predecessor here was an Irish priest, his name was Father John Johnson, and he wasn't at all happy with the establishment of a holiday centre being established by Mr. Butlin from England, because he felt that it was going to bring a pagan way of life into this country and that it would ruin all the people that would be on holidays here and workers and have a very adverse effect upon the parish. But of course, it went ahead anyway. He didn't succeed in stopping it. But I think the morals of the people who are on holidays in this holiday centre would be just a reflection of what happens in the rest of the country. But I'll tell you one thing. We hear more. I hear more confessions here in the 3 months in the summer than I do for the rest of the year in the parish.
There was a lot of people came from England and the North who would have been Church of Ireland or Church of England. And in those days, the ballroom was used for the service on Sunday morning. In those early days, you get up to 200 and 300 Protestant people coming to the services here. But of course, when the trouble started in the North, a lot of that stopped. So now our attendance is not anything like as good, and sometimes pretty miserable indeed. I came here in 1949, and I found it a marvellous time. I was only 20 or so at the time. I very enjoyed it. Very simple. It was different in some ways from what it is today, because in those days there was only one pub, one licensed bar in the premises, and there were no slot machines. It was a very basic, simple family holiday. This has been my experience, that Northern Protestants don't come here during the holiday weeks in the North. I think perhaps because a lot of Roman Catholics from the North would come here and fill up the holiday camp for the whole fortnight, because they were getting away from the pressures and stresses of the North.
We love to get down here. It breaks the monotony away from where we come from, Belfast, because we've had no share of troubles and all of that this last 30 years. So we're glad to get down here. We know where we're going back to, you know. A bit of a shooting gallery.
At the beginning, when we started coming, about 30 years ago, Protestant people that I had worked with, even before that, I used to meet them here. And Protestants got on very well. For years they came.
That's right, every year.
Every year. Oh. And I maybe hadn't seen them from 1 year to the next year. But they did all start coming at the beginning. There was no bigotry then. Yeah. But then the troubles really started. And then they stopped coming.
I always remember great memories, and family memories are very good.
just great entertainment there was for everybody years ago. Like, you had the discos for the young people, and the red coat shows were very, very good. And the red coats really got into the children and helped them with everything they needed help with, and there'd always time for children.
If 30 of you work together...
So far, I'm all settled in, thank God. It's a big change from the last time you saw the chalet. I've got, like, I'm personalised the whole thing, so everything's going well at that front. It's mid-season now, so there's, like, it's practically full now. So we've got loads of people around all the time. So everybody's getting more comfortable with their job as well. It's second nature to be a red coat at this stage. It's just what we are at the moment. You're dealing with the people all the time, and when you're a whiz kid especially, after the show all the kids are bombarding you and pulling at your hair and seeing like a, getting you to dance with them and sing with them, but it's great fun. I've missed home a little bit, but I'm kept busy all the time, and all my friends here have become a second family. What about romance? I don't know what to say. You're blushing now, you put me on the spot. What about romance? Yeah, there's romance, I'm sure. For some people.
When I'm feeling blue, all I had to do is take a look at you. Then I'm not so blue. When you're close to me, I can feel your heartbeat. I can hear you breathing in my ear. Wouldn't you agree? Baby, you and me got a groovy kind of love. We've got a groovy kind of love.
David and my relationship, it's a true holiday. Holiday camp romance. We met in Butlins Patheli in North Wales. I'd been a red coat here for the season of 94, and we closed in September. And I went straight over to Patheli to start work as a red coat there. And David was already a red coat in Patheli. And as I arrived, he greeted me, and the first thing he said was, "Hiya, Shelley, my name's David, and you're going to be my girlfriend one day."
I came out of the most stupid thing in the world, which was, "Hi, my name's David, and you're going to be my girlfriend one day." And all of a sudden, I was mortified because I thought, that's it, I've blown any chance at all of ever being with her. And now we are, 4 years later, and I'm marrying her.
I remember the moment that I actually fell in, actually fell properly in love with David. It was in about November 94, about 2 weeks before we left Butlins to go our separate ways. And he, we were very, very shy with each other. Very shy. So, you know, we were both quite shy with each other. And he was lying face down on my bed, and he said, "Do you know something, Shelley?" And I said, "What's that?" And he said, "I love you."
When I see Shelley on stage, I view her in two ways. One, because I'm up in the box twiddling with the sound, I view her as the artiste down on the stage, and we do have our disagreements, as every technician and every performer does. But at the same time, I'm looking down, and I'm thinking, well, she's brilliant, and she's fantastic. That's my wife to be. I'm her biggest fan, and she is absolutely brilliant at what she does.
You must be, with a face like that, you've got to be a princess.
I think once David and I are married and we're officially husband and wife, I think we will come back for a couple of years anyway, as seasonal staff. From then on,
how old are you, Lacey?
Goodness only knows.
And where are you from?
Kirkfergus.
Is Lacey, who's 8.
In its own way, it's a holiday camp romance, because it's sort of, we met in a holiday centre, we've always worked together in holiday centres, we've always spent our time working together, living together, so we're together more or less 24 hours a day now. And people, when we first met, said, "Oh, when you meet at a holiday centre, it would never ever work. Won't work, because you're split up at the end of season. Your eye will wander a bit here and there because you meet so many different people." But it's never happened to us. We've always been together, and always been really happy being together. So we've totally proved everybody wrong who's ever said it won't work.
No problem getting a woman in Mosney. This is no problem. I've been working here about 9 years, and there's always the girls, like, you know. I suppose the first time I was here, I got into the crack of being with me mates, like, you know, having a drink. having a bit of crack with the girls, whatever, like, you know, and I just kept coming back. Anything you want to do. You could go to bed, you don't have to go to bed, it could be, you might meet up with them next year, you might meet them next year, or else you might go off and it could be marriage, like, you know, that's all the way. I was with a girl last year and I thought that was the one. She was really the girl for me, but it didn't happen. So I was always told Mosney romances did not work. There's one or two maybe out of the thousands that happened here. But after that, like, you know, after last year, I don't know, just day at a time. Day at a time.
The time is now 7:30. The first sitting breakfast will be served in the dining room at 8 o'clock.
In its Butlin's heyday, the Mosney kitchens churned out three full meals per day for over 2,000 ravenous campers at a time. It was all done with military precision, and meal times were broken into first and second sittings to cope with the throng. Nowadays, meal times are slightly calmer affairs.
Well, I joined Butlin's was then in the 19th of June 1948. And we've continued with them since, ever since. Well, in Butlin's time, we used to do 2,000 meals for breakfast and lunch and evening meal. People's eating habits are still the same. And some of them are a bit choosy, maybe, but we satisfy them.
Good morning.
Hi.
Hiya. Are you well this morning?
Yeah.
Yeah, enjoying your breakfast?
Yeah.
Up late last night, were you?
Yeah.
In the ballroom last night to see the show.
In Butlin days, the average at peak time here, you'd have 3,500 to 4,000 people. Therefore, the quantity of material I would be buying, the various items, would be a lot more than I'm buying the present day. And we have about 700 pairs of skates here in stores at the moment. They're not used now because of the number of people who are having accidents on these skates. The skating rink now is now used as a crazy golf course. I was the first qualified teacher in Ireland in 1948. I was in the army at the time and I went to Loughborough College and I specialised in swimming and came out with an honours in teaching. When I left the army then, I came in here every summer. I taught the swimming here to children and to adults. So thousands of children learned to swim here in 1 week. The lifeguards which were employed and which I interviewed, most of those lifeguards, some of them were very good divers. And we used to have, in the afternoons, we used to have what's called a diving display. And I would commentate on the diving. We also carried out life-saving displays in the afternoon. And this was very, very popular with the guests. They sat around the outdoor pool and we did all forms of life-saving, the Royal Life-Saving Society and the other Irish Water Safety Association.
Sweet, sweet memories you gave of me. You can't beat the memories you gave.
The O'Connor family from Glenageary are back in Mosney for the first time in over 20 years.
I think it formed the background to the fact that we're all so close.
The footage that our dad took brought back great memories to all the family who would remember all the details.
I remember for the first 10 years of my life, this is where I spent my holidays every year.
Well, my main memory of it is the swimming pool, and you could spend all day in it, and we spent all day in it.
Don't forget us all.
Stop there, please, to stay in there.
And I think that was all the chalets had different colours.
The memories you gave me.
It wasn't like blue, red, yellow, blue, red, yellow. They were dotted different colours. It was no shape or form of the colours system.
First sitting
for breakfast
seven.
Was 8 o'clock,
yeah.
And we always went to the first.
And you got
Good morning, campers.
Zip-a-dee-doo-da, zip-a-dee-day. My, oh my, what a wonderful day. Sunshine coming my way. Zip-a-dee-doo-da, zip-a-dee-day.
We stopped coming here when I was about 7, but when I look at all the cinnies, I mean, it brings back such memories, and it was lovely to spend all the time together with the family.
Helen shared the chalet with Gay and myself, and we shared a bedroom at home together.
And sadly, Helen passed away 2 weeks ago, so it certainly does bring back a lot of memories here.
Before they opened the indoor swimming pool, we used to spend, I suppose, anything up to 6-7 hours a day out here. And it wasn't heated, but we never felt the cold. There were 3 diving boards over there and the lifeguard over there. You spent so much time by the pool that you inevitably got to know the lifeguards, as in knowing, joking, racing with them, diving with them. You know, it was all good, innocent fun, really.
And I remember for the first couple of years I used to go off the springboard, which was the low one, and then they had an intermediate springboard, and about after 3 or 4 years I was diving off the top board, and of course it's not there anymore.
I remember the food was good. It, certainly, I used to think it was great. Well, coming from a family of 10, we used to get things that we wouldn't have got at home here, you know.
Soup. A lot of chicken, and it was always served on white crockery. Always served on white crockery, and the girls used to come from the kitchen and they had these tiered little things that held all the plates with the food on them, and then they bring them out and give them around.
The other thing is, I always remember the noise level was very, very high, because you probably had about, you know, 500 or 600 people all dining together. So everybody talking, I mean, the noise level was incredible. So there was a great atmosphere in the dining room.
The children here love it today. We see it a little differently, but the children love it here today. So it's different through the eyes of a child.
Memories are made of this.
Well, when I started here in 1973, I was only 18 years of age. I'm now 44, and it was a great day. I suppose, in one sense, my first season of Redcoat was probably my best season ever here, because I was never here before. It was a great novelty to me. Whereas now, you have the full responsibility of putting the entertainment guide together each week for the following week. And if all the problems, like bands ringing up, I can't do tonight, you have to get another band at the last minute and stuff of that nature.
If the audience boo, that means you must show more leg. Are you married?
No, I'm not.
Yeah, you meet so many people over the years. They only come down once a year then, for a week during the season, that you've met 25 years ago and you've kept friends with them. Like, you go to different parts of the country. You could go to Killarney, you could go to Donegal, and there's always somebody who would know you through Mosney. I suppose I'm not as great as I could be, health-wise, all right. Unfortunately, I was diagnosed with cancer of the bowel last September. So when I was told in hospital in Dunleary, I didn't know whether to laugh or cry. But I got over it, thanks to the skill of the doctors and the nurses in Dunleary and all the staff down in Vince's Hospital in Merion. I've completed 24 sessions of chemotherapy, and I've done a few scans, liver scans, etc., etc. So unfortunately, while they can't cure it, they can contain it. So once they can do that, I'm happy enough, and I think at this stage of the game, it's mind over matter. You can sit at home and mope and say, why me? But looking up the job I'm in, you're out and about and you're meeting different people and doing different things every day and night. So that's what really keeps me going.
Right, here we go. The 1, 2, 3. Third place in this week's Lovely Legs competition goes to Lovely Legs contestant number 23. And here she is. A nice round of applause for the lady as she comes out. Congratulations to you. Well done, Dean.
Well, certainly, I'd be a liar to say that it hasn't entered my mind at the back of it, thinking that this could be my last season, but I have to look at it from a positive angle and say to myself, well, please God, it won't, and that next year, 99, I'll be here for the 27th season in a row.
Lovely Legs, contestant number 17. congratulations to you. Just walk down the ramp there. Give her a big round of applause then.
Yes, the stars truly do float here at Mosney, and that old sea dog Noel Purcell can really show these young folk how to make a splash. Film actress Anne Blythe takes a rest from the Hollywood grind, and she might even meet that perky Cockney crooner Tommy Steele, or spar a few rounds with 1950 world champion boxer Lee Savold. This is the life of rising young TV star Eamon Andrews, and maybe these two lovelies will be TV stars as well one day. Get your skates on, campers, because Noel's back. And he's brought his old chum, Jimmy O'Dea. Steady on there, you giddy old goat funny men. Don't go giving up those day jobs just yet. All the good folk of Edda have been dying to meet the good quads, those four little biological wonders born in Blighty back in 48. And where else would a quartet of lively young lassies choose to go on holidays than to Edda's favourite pleasure garden? Watch out, little miss. There's no shab-a-dab on that naughty post. Yes, at Mosney, they're hailing the good quads as a modern miracle. But all too soon, it's time to go home. Bye-bye, good quads. We're all going to miss you. At Mosney, we never miss a chance to keep fit. And these figure-conscious beauties are hopping with health. Yes, this truly is the right way to relax from the stresses and strains of the modern world. Bula bus, Mosney. You absolutely do know how to make a chap feel on top of the world.
But Mosney is all about children, entertaining them, making them even.
Sex on the beach. I never had sex on the beach. I never even seen the beach. That's the truth. I never even seen the beach.
Where they used to have the creche over there for the kids, it was grand. Like, there's nothing like that now for the smaller kids. Put them over there into the creche and go back and do your business.
That's what
I have. I can see three kids down here. My kids come down here now with their kids, and my young one goes to Betty's young flat. And they conceived their child down here.
She took advantage of him down here. That's what she did, didn't she, Irene? Tell the truth. She did, really. It was great for the young kids years ago, now. You hadn't got to bring anything with you. Everything was over there. If you had food, any amount of food.
Babysitting in the night time, you put your name down on the babysitting, and the people go up and down, check on the shallies. If they heard the child crying, you tell them where you'd be in Dan Leary's, then they'd go over to Dan Leary's, and then next to all, you get announced, baby crying in shally RD114, say, so you just got up.
Kenzie, all the way from Dublin, ladies and gentlemen.
Who would be a judge at a bonny baby competition? But judge they do, and judge they always have done. Generations of chubby, coochie, gurgly infants get to make their mammies proud at Mosney with their lovely edible number cards and the occasional winning smile. It's early August and Lorraine is now a fully naturalised citizen of Mosneyland.
I just finished the teenage disco mount and I'm whack tired. Philip and I are heading over to the staff right now to get a cup of tea to wind down after the April. Philip has to go back to work, but I'm finished for the night. We're going to hook up with Olivia and Mike because it's Shelley and David's wedding soon and we have to start planning the stag night and the hen night. So that's what we're going to do now.
I'm trying on my dress today.
What's it like?
Oh, it's gorgeous. It's a little bit big, but it'll be okay.
I can't wait to try it on.
It's blue. Electric blue.
It would have to be electric.
Paddy and Irish Jessen, as Jessen and Farrelly, were one of Ireland's most popular variety acts.
Well, most people remember as Paddy and Irish. I mean, if you go to Mosney and ask anybody, Paddy and Irish. So we got married in 1945, and in 1954, Jack Cruz offered us a contract for Mosney when we arrived down for rehearsals. Lovely theatre, beautiful camp, absolutely a fairyland. A typical day, we start on Sunday, after church services, into the ballroom with everybody, and they've done all their exercises to music, keep fit. Everybody, men, women, children, grandmas, granddads, a lot. Then there was the selection for the Queen of Hearts, which was equivalent to the Holiday Princess. Then there was roller skating matches, on the roller skating rink. And then came the big event of the evening, the grand variety show. Now, we'd done that twice nightly. And the night ended with a Butlin half hour, which was Bumps the Daisy, the Butlin Valley, those type of dances. My son, Kyron, was born in 1957. And I loved my work. I loved the theatre. But I loved my son. So I never went anywhere without him. So there's nothing about Butlins that he doesn't know.
I was five when my mum and dad first started to tread the boards in Mosney. My early memories sort of relate back to when I was the youngest redcoat. So at the age of six, my mother had me in a red jacket and white shorts, and I had to come out onto the stage at the end of the redcoat finale with all the redcoats and sort of take me bow. And having been brought up in Butlins, when I got to 16, I decided that enough was enough, and I'd try my luck and do other things. And I worked in Henry Street in Dublin as a salesman. When I rejoined Butlins, I went to Bognor Regis on the management training scheme, and fortunately now I'm the entertainment director for the Butlins Group, which is owned by the Rank Group.
Believe it or not, it was 1951. Somebody had gotten sick, and I came down here to work with Danny Cummins. In the early days, Jack Crew reigned supreme here for many, many years, and we the tops of people here, Cecil Sheridan.
I said, I want my teeth out. Well, he said, he want gas. I said, yes, I wouldn't have you mucking around in the dark. When I got up, missing, there wasn't a tooth in my head. Wasn't a tooth in my head. I said, take out the back one. He said, I'm a trade unionist, one out, all out.
And this is the last long summer season of variety that we have left. And may it last for a few more years.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday.
It's the last week of the 50th season. And following a big cake to celebrate Mosney's Golden Jubilee birthday, the best of the junior talent contestants are back for the grand end of season talent finals.
Welcome to the 1998 team sponsored junior competition.
Could it be that some of these talented children will grow up to become Mosney Redcoats?
My forest.
Perhaps they'll carry the Mosney tradition into the new millennium.
Looking back over the past couple of months, it's been brilliant and it's given me a taste of what I want to do. When you're up there and you get your chance to come out and everybody's just looking at you, and then you sing your song, and then when you're finished, you hear people cheering for you, and they know that they're cheering because they appreciate what you're after doing, and it's just the best buzz ever when you come off the stage. It's just brilliant. I've made fabulous friends because seeing each other every day, every night is like a family. And definitely we'll all keep in touch because I'd hate to think of not seeing half of these people again because we've gotten so close. We might not all see each other again, but at least we have Shelley and David's wedding coming up and we'll all be back together again for a big reunion. And that'll just be great. We'll be able to look back on the last couple of months.
It's the end of the season. Sincerely, thanks very much for all your effort and all your help over it. I said to you at the start of the season, we had a few problems. We got over them, we overcame them. It went grand. Thanks very much indeed. Irrespective if we don't see you here next year, whatever you do to further your career, the best of luck to you. Good night, God bless. And can we have three cheers to the King? Hip hip.
It's all over. It's the end now.
I miss you loads.
You too. Phone me as soon as you get home.
Okay. Okay. In a couple of days, okay?
Love you loads.
Miss you.
Yeah, me too.
Stop.
See you later. I'm heading back to Kilkenny now. I'll stay there for a while, a couple of weeks maybe, just to settle back into things, get back to reality. and decide what I'm going to do. I've been bitten now by the performance buzz and I don't want to let it go. I'm determined to keep going. So I'll give myself a few weeks and then see where life takes me after that.
We say goodbye.
Good night, campers. I can see you yawning. Good night, campers. See you in the morning. You must cheer up or you'll soon be dead. I've heard it said that folk die in bed. So we say good night, campers. Don't sleep in your braces. Good night, campers. Soak your teeth in Jesus. Drown your sorrows. Bring your bottles back tomorrow. Good night, campers. Good night.